If everyone would please take their seats, I will momentarily be turning it over to the chair of this next panel, Sakiko Fukudapar. Just as a reminder, I just wanted to repeat what I had said before everyone rushed out to grab a cup of coffee, which I fully understand, that we have two really wonderful panels left this afternoon, and I would really strongly encourage everyone to stay through the end of the day, because as is often said, we save the best for last for these two panels. And I think that Sakiko Fukudapar will introduce this next set of panelists, and I'll just acknowledge that one of our speakers has to duck out in the middle of the panel, but obviously with no disrespect to his co-panelists, but has another obligation. But I wanted to also just call everyone's attention to the fact that the last panel that will follow this one after a short coffee break is really unique in that it's trying to bring what has been mostly a conversation about the international tax system down also to the local domestic level to talk not only about how the system itself and international trans-border inequalities affect human rights, but also to look at the ways in which the design and administration and enforcement of tax policies affects human rights can often reflect discriminatory policies or have discriminatory effects, and to really focus the discussion on those intersections around inequality. So I will leave it to Sakiko to introduce this panel, and to all of our panelists here, thank you in advance.
Thank you very much. This has been really a wonderfully interesting conference. So this session is on the role of international organizations, the architecture of international tax reform. And we have speakers who will be talking about the roles of these different international organizations. We first have Matti Ylonen, who is a Fulbright PhD student from Yale University. Then we will have Michael Lennard, who is the chief of International Tax Cooperation and Trade Unit in the UN Financing for Development Office. And then followed by Erika Siu, who is an ICRICT consultant. She was an alum of the NYU Tax LLM. Finally, we will hear from Annet, Wanyana, Oguttu from the University of South Africa and her co-author, Monica Iyer, who is also an NYU alum and is currently an independent consultant. So I'd like to invite Matti to the floor to speak. I think it's all because I was trying to hear a better height.
Thank you very much, and also my personal apologies for having to duck out from here a bit later. So I'm going to speak about a paper titled Who's to Blame for the Money Train? And I would like to take a step back from some of the discussions that we've been having today and yesterday and look at some of the ways how illicit activities in developing countries have been addressed during the past decades. And I would especially like to focus on two narratives that have been used to explain why resources are being lost in many developing countries. Well, the first one is an obvious one, corporate tax avoidance, corporate power, all these themes that we have been discussing for these past 2 days. The second one that I'm going to address is corruption. And when you think about these narratives or discourses, the typical image is that the corporate tax avoidance is sort of a new thing in development policy agenda, whereas corruption has been around, or anti-corruption activities have been around for a long time. Well, I went through a quite large body of material from different UN agencies and also the OECD from the late 1960s. To 1980s, and I found a fascinating body of analysis on corporate tax avoidance, tax evasion, tax havens, and so on and so forth, which actually preceded the current attention and paradigm around the anti-corruption efforts. And personally, I was also surprised how recent the whole anti-corruption agenda is, that it basically rose to prominence in 1990s. And I just think that these are some of the issues that could be considered if hopefully the tax and human rights agenda will gain more support and backing. So to start with the UN work on taxation, it basically happened in took place in two strands. The first one was the what is today known as the UN Tax Committee that began in late 1960s as an ad hoc working group of experts and tax administrators. And these early forms of UN Tax Committee, these groups, they produced interesting analyses already in the 1970s. But even in a more central role is this little-known organization called United Nations Center for Transnational Corporations, which basically its background is that after the coup in Chile in 1972, the Chilean ambassador to the UN requested the UN to study the role of multinational corporations in developing countries. And as a result to this plea, the UN established a group of eminent persons comprising of academics and private sector representatives and officials and so on that produced a couple of very interesting reports and recommended that the permanent center should be established under the United Nations umbrella. And the UNCTC began its operation in 1975. And the main task of UNCTC was to establish code of conduct for multinational corporations. So when Alison yesterday mentioned the OECD code of conduct, basically the OECD code of conduct was set up after the UN started its work because the OECD saw UN as a competitor to its work. And basically the UN work on the code of conduct forced the OECD to take more ambitious stance, which is something that could be reflected even today when we think about how to formulate different demands and how much to focus on the kind of fine-tuning the existing laws or demanding something much bigger. So just to give a few examples on the UN work from the 1970s, this is one of the first reports by the group of eminent persons from 1974, the impact of multinational corporations on development and on international relations. And there's a fascinating, very well-matured analysis in this report and others. So for example, regarding the power of multinational corporations, the report stated that because of their size and transnational nature of their activities, multinational corporations possess considerable power and influence. And what is more, the transnational flexibility of these multinational corporations, because of this transnational flexibility, they can engage in transfer pricing, abusive transfer pricing, monopolistic practices, price setting, this kind of behavior. And this is just two examples. There are so many more of them. But the UN work, it also focused on finding solutions. And some of them are very familiar to discussions we've been having during these 2 days. For example, another report published in 1974 discussed the unitary taxation. Even though it did not endorse unitary taxation, it still portrayed it as an effective cure to some of the problems they had discovered. Moreover, this is from the 1983 version of the Code of Conduct that never really materialized. Then the Latin American debt crisis had already started and Ronald Reagan was in power and all that. And the negotiations basically stalled. But very interestingly, it's very complicated and long sentence, but basically it boils down to the demand that multinational corporations should not engage in abusive transfer pricing. So this was something that was going to be part of the United Nations Code of Conduct, would it have been ever completed. And interestingly, the OECD Code of Conduct also had a bit similar language at that time. It was deleted in the 1990s after the UN threat had kind of dissolved. The UNCTC was ended its operations in 1993. And then from the other strand, the tax treaty strand, there was already in 1970 a recognition that the current system of bilateral tax treaties, it's not efficient, we need better international cooperation. So all of this happened basically some two decades or one decade before the so-called economic globalization began, which is really fascinating. Now then turning to the other paradigm or other discourse I'm discussing in the paper, the corruption discourse. Now there were many reasons why the anti-corruption agenda emerged, but I argue in the paper that one of them was that the UN agenda was forgotten, the tax avoidance agenda was forgotten, and there was more room for this kind of focus on the mismanagement of public resources by officials to emerge. And this is one of the landmark books in anti-corruption history, Controlling Corruption by Robert Glitkard. It's from 1988, and as late as that, Glitkard argued that the literature on international development is surprisingly silent about corruption. And what is more, corruption is devouring the economies and polities of many third world nations, and yet the students of development policy tend to ignore it. So it is actually only during the 1990s when the whole anti-corruption narrative started to gain more following. And one of the high moments for that was the annual meeting address of James Wolfensohn, the then president of the World Bank, in 1996, when he called for a new pact for development and stated that let's not mince words, we need to deal with the cancer of corruption. And basically after that, the development community and also scholars researching development, very many of them turned their attention to these anti-corruption efforts. And then the first kind of signs of change started to emerge only in late 1990s. And in a key role in this was a landmark report by Global Witness NGO, Crude Awakening, that documented the poor state of Angola and human development in Angola and the complicity of the oil companies in these problems. And this was the opening statement of that report by Secretary of State Madeleine Albright that basically set the tone that it's ultimately the state's leaders that are responsible for this corruption, even though the oil companies also have a role. And this was enforced in the later efforts for extractive industry transparency initiative and so on and so forth. So after all this, we are now in a situation where the tax justice movement has emerged and there's basically the corruption, anti-corruption discourse is still there, but it has been coupled with this or simultaneously existing this tax justice movement. And here on the left corner, there's the 1998 report by OECD, which many of the tax people here recognize, harmful tax competition. And I argue that one of the reasons why the kind of older historical roots of these current initiatives have not been recognized is that actually this OECD report, it only cites one other OECD report from 1980s, and all the other references are much more later origin. So it basically set the tone and portrayed that OECD is inventing something really new and great here and so on and so forth. So to conclude, the emergence of anti-corruption agenda was not a result of particular increase of corruption in the 1990s or late 1980s, and this is something that researchers of corruption also acknowledge. And I argue that one important factor was the demise of the UNCTC's agenda and the way it was forgotten at the time. And following this, one of the challenges is how to build a more coherent framework of analysis that takes into account the responsibility of both the private sector and the public officials. If someone is interested in the articles, please feel free to write an email. Thanks.
Start with a cartoon, 1775 style, and then I'll whiz through a whole lot of points in my remaining 8 minutes. This is a little hard to read, but the interesting thing is the very modern title, Virtual Representation. And this is the response to No Taxation Without Representation, which actually started with the English during the English Civil War. And then was used against them by the Americans, and now it's being used both against them and other developed countries by developing countries. Here's a line drawing which makes it a little bit easy to see what's happening. There was a lot happening in 1775, so the centre grouping of three, numbers 1, 4, and 5, are the tax people. On the left, your left, the man with the blunderbuss, number 1, I think, is saying, deliver your property. And number 5, with the cudgel up, is saying, I will not be robbed. And number 4, who is the virtual representative of number 5, is saying to the robber, I give you that man's money for my use. And he was the virtual representative. This was the view taken by Samuel Johnson and others that, in actual fact, the citizens of America were fully represented because the representatives of, you know, Oxford, the small Oxford electorates, actually had the interests of the British Empire as a whole at heart, so they were fully representing the American, the colonists. And this is a reflection on the value of that. And this is from Wikipedia. The British Parliament claimed that their members had the well-being of the colonists in mind. The colonies rejected this premise. So this is part of the more things change, the more they stay the same. And I won't make any further comment. This presentation is entirely my own thoughts. I don't attribute it to the UN or the UN Tax Committee. Some of, I think, the issues which are important to this tax and human rights debate, which relate to the international architecture, and I've sort of put it in terms of an operating system, because I think there is an operating system, an OECD G20 international tax cooperation operating system being developed, and I think a lot of people are missing that it's not just about particular rules, it's about a system that's being developed. And the first thing is, who decides the basic product lines, as I've called them? Well, the action plan, the BEPS action plan, was really decided without any developing country input. I don't think anyone can say other than that. The multilateral legal instrument, there is said to be some developing country input, but it's really hard to judge because that instrument is secret at the moment, and really it will only become public when it's concluded. Some of the BEPS issues, when you go through them, a lot of them you speak to developing countries and they might say, this issue is important to me, this issue is important to me. But often when you speak more deeply, they say, but it's not a priority at the moment. I really need to know who my taxpayers are. I really need to get the basic systems in place. I need to get the resources in place, including the computer resources and the skilled people. So there's a lot of feeling amongst a lot of developing countries that BEPS doesn't sufficiently speak to the issues for them in their current taxation quest, even with multinational enterprises. But BEPS also doesn't deal with a lot of important things for developing countries. It really doesn't deal with withholding taxes, and for developing countries, withholding taxes are a clumsy but often the most effective way to deal with base erosion and profit shifting. At least you get something. You don't have to trace residency around the world. You don't have to look for intricate issues of where profit arises, you just take a gross amount on withholding. And it needs to be thought about, a withholding tax system, but it's a very important part of developing countries dealing with tax evasion, which is really not dealt at all within the OECD plan. And that's not necessarily criticism of the OECD, it's just saying for OECD countries, withholding taxes are not as important as some of these other issues. Much more important for developing countries. The issues of source country taxation versus residence country taxation, what's the best balance and what are the implications of the different balances? It isn't really dealt with in BEPS, partly because the idea is that's about what your base is, not whether it's being eroded. And there's some logic to that, but this is a really important issue, and I think one reason why the digital economy aspect of the OECD work didn't go very far, because it would inevitably lead to more countries, including developed countries, saying we want more source country taxation. So there's an attempt to hold the line on too much source country taxation, but it's becoming more difficult to hold that line, because even developed countries in the areas of services and the digital economy are becoming more source country oriented, because they're not the source, they're the capital importers, not the capital exporters. And BEPS is really not specifically about personal taxation, though. There are some aspects that relate to that. Some of the issues of the BEPS process is, what does participation on an equal footing really mean? Can you be in an equal footing when you're not really a member of the body that is inviting you to join the procedure? A lot of the BEPS results have been shaped around OECD country legislation and ways of doing things, most obviously in the patent box solution, but also in limitation of benefits, where it wasn't even finalised until the US could finalise, and I think it still hasn't been finalised, the OECD approach, because they're waiting for the US to finalise the approach. And also it fits in with the European Union, allows them to depart from the rules. There are fees involved in joining BEPS. You really join the major things like the inclusive forum, technically you join by invitation, not by right. Is that the right approach to an international way of dealing with taxation? Even if you're invited, can you attend the meetings? We have virtually no resources in the UN, so I can't attend any of the meetings. So, you know, is it worse to be invited and be unable to attend than to not be invited at all? I'll leave you to decide that. And what's the role of the Secretariat? BEPS is a huge, complex, sprawling mass of very technical work. So it gives great power to the Secretariat, which is responsible to OECD and is in key areas, it's people from OECD countries. And those countries which have the best connections with the Secretariat will obviously have an entree that other countries won't. Who does the interpretation? This is one of the interesting issues at the moment, the role of the Secretariat and of the OECD in interpreting, for example, the multilateral instrument, which will affect countries, even if it's a later interpretation. The monitoring, what role will developing countries play in monitoring their own, the way in which they've actually met their BEPS obligations, if they commit to the minimum BEPS requirements? What will be the sanctions be? What will be their impact? Will the whole process be used to further push mandatory binding arbitration, even though it hasn't been required? There'll no doubt be a lot of pressure on the OECD to push that, particularly from business and some of the bigger developed countries. Transparency is seen as very important in BEPS, but is there enough transparency in the norm setting that BEPS is really about? Most of the developing country involvement in BEPS is after the norms have been set. It's in the implementation, and then there's a huge attempt to get as many countries involved as possible. I won't read through this slide. It's about the UN system, and it's really reflected in the slides I'm going to go through now. There's the long-standing issue we've heard of whether the UN Tax Committee should be an intergovernmental body. A little hard to follow because every OECD tax body is an intergovernmental body. So why is it that developed countries don't want the UN Tax Committee to be intergovernmental? Will it meet twice a year? That seems to be a simple issue, but it's a huge issue at the moment. And if so, does it meet in New York? If it meets in New York, developing countries want it to meet in New York. Developed countries generally don't want it to meet in New York. Here's a little center of concern is represented here by Aldo, but I won't go through this. This is to reflect issues like the intergovernmental status of the committee and also the equal footing in tax forms is still an issue in which will be raised again and again. Just in closing, I think the possibilities, the relevance to the tax and human rights debate are first of all that this transparency needs to be sought in norm setting, not just in what those norms are. And I think this is directly relevant to some of the things Winnie raised. I think we need to formalise a little bit more the role of NGOs and academias and make sure that the unrepresented, the people who will most benefit from the development role of taxation can be met. Finally, the important issue at the moment and the fact that developing countries are becoming very much more aggressive on these issues is that tax is a very political issue, it's a very diplomatic issue, and there's a push to tie it in with the sustainable development goals, including, I think that's one of the reasons why there's a push to meet in New York. And I think this is an entree to try and merge the tax and human rights goals. Thank you. While my voice still survives.
Well, thank you for the invitation to speak at this conference. It's really a joy to be back and to see these two exciting disciplines merge and kind of create some new energy. I was asked to speak on how to build human rights into the international tax system and speak on the role of international organizations working in tax. So as Michael alluded to earlier, we are now seeing the solidification of a new international tax architecture. With the G20 at the top delivering mandates to the OECD as the international norm setter on tax. And then the OECD is also a member of this platform of collaboration on tax matters with the IMF, the World Bank Group, and the UN Financing for Development Office, kind of banding together to help translate the norms developed in processes like the BEPS process, help developing countries come up to speed on the implementation. And I have the League of Nations there in the gray box to show a thing of the past, a relic, in terms of the development of the double tax conventions alongside the OECD model. And Annet and Monica's paper does a great job of going through that history, so I would highly recommend that paper. So there are two major tax reform streams that have been led by the G20 through their mandates to the OECD. And these reform streams have multilateral legal instruments. So there was talk this morning about tax being governed by a series of bilateral tax agreements. Well, now we're moving into a multilateral agreement stage. And the legal instrument, the primary one for tax transparency, is the Convention on Mutual Administrative Assistance in Tax Matters. There's 103 signatories of last month. These numbers are changing every day. More countries are signing on as we speak. There's also a multilateral competent authority agreement for the common reporting standard that arises under Article 6 of the convention. There are 84 signatories of that agreement. There is also an implementation/peer review body, and that is the Global Forum. Global Forum, I think, has 138 countries now who have joined to help implement the standards of the CRS and under the automatic exchange of information. So what we've heard through the OECD is that countries have got to meet two of the three bulleted requirements by next June, or they'll in effect be considered for blacklisting. by the member countries of the G20. So the first requirement is a compliance rating of largely compliant by the Global Forum, committing to automatic exchange of information at least by 2018 under the Common Reporting Standard, and participation in this convention or a sufficient bilateral network of information exchange, which is a way out for countries who have opted not to sign on to that convention. Under the reform stream for tax standards, the kind of the corporate tax norms, the BEPS process, again mandated by the G20, produced four minimum standards on model provisions for tax treaty abuse, country-by-country reporting, relaunching the Forum on Harmful Tax Practices that was launched as part as this 1998 report by the OECD on harmful tax practices, where they dealt with issues like patent boxes and the nexus principle, and also an agreement to secure progress on improving dispute resolution under the mutual agreement procedure. Again, a tax treaty issue. Under BEPS, there are multilateral legal instruments. First, there is the Multilateral Competent Authority Agreement for country-by-country reporting. And again, that can arise under Article 6 of the previous mentioned Multilateral Convention on Mutual Assistance in Tax Affairs. There is also this multilateral instrument, which Michael referred to earlier, which is now being negotiated by a group of 96 countries. This is interesting because this multilateral instrument was designed to overlay onto existing double tax agreements that are entered by countries on a bilateral basis. But interestingly, you know, the provisions, they're different because some countries are not opting for certain measures. So again, similar to the CRS, there will be matches on which countries have opted for different provisions. And those options stem directly from the BEPS process and the BEPS recommendations, with the exception of one provision, which is being negotiated, and that's the provision on arbitration. The arbitration provision under the BEPS process was solidly rejected, particularly by the non-OECD BRIC countries in that process. However, it's been resurrected, it's gained a second life, and now it will be negotiated, albeit as an optional provision, but every other provision that was agreed through the BEPS process was also optional. So that's an interesting phenomenon of that. And there will be a peer review body. It's called the BEPS Inclusive Framework. Now there are 84 countries. And the non-OECD countries will have BEPS associate status within the Committee of Fiscal Affairs. So equal footing, associate. I want to be a partner. But anyway. So my job at looking at the international tax architecture and legal instruments, I'm a tax attorney, and so I think this is more of my field of expertise. So when I thought, well, how can I compare that to the human rights standards? So I went to the treaties. And because you want to find a body of law that's binding on countries who are also participating in these tax multilateral treaties, so you have some kind of mechanism to hold them accountable. So I looked at the ICCSR, and of course Article 2 says allocate the maximum available resources, but also something very important is the ICCPR, which is civil and political rights. And that, under Article 25, every citizen has the right to participate in processes of public affairs. And the Human Rights Committee has explained that this is a broad concept. And it includes not only local domestic affairs, but also international affairs. And then the Maastricht principles, which can be a source of international law, says that everyone has the right to informed participation in decisions which affect their human rights. The UN Charter emphasizes international cooperation and states' duties to cooperate. The Maastricht Principle 17 says that states must elaborate, interpret, apply relevant international agreements and standards in a manner consistent with their human rights obligations, and list taxation as one of those areas. Also to create an international enabling environment conducive to the fulfillment of these rights, including taxation. Also, these principles prohibit both direct and indirect interference that impairs the ability of other states to meet their human rights obligations, or even aids or directs or assists through international organizations. And they have the duty to regulate non-state actors. Okay, so based on this, I'll take Professor Kay's modest conclusion. I posit that there have been human rights violations going on in the area of tax. And in my paper, I identify three categories. The first is spillovers, and there are case studies of Panama and the Ireland and US. The area of top-down legislation created through forums like the G20 through the OECD to set norms. But most importantly, the fact that governments are not represented on an intergovernmental level, on a universal level, it prevents civil society and citizens of countries from holding their own leaders to account when those international tax norms and standards are being set. And this is a direct interference with the participation of citizens. So recommendations for an overhaul of the international tax or architecture would be universality. This is a very firm human rights principle. Second one would be non-interference. This means that governments should not be corporate ambassadors. It means that they should not adopt tax policies that have adverse effects on other countries' ability to collect taxes within their own borders. And we must take seriously the duty to regulate corporations. Now, one last point. It is very important for states to have funds to enable the fulfillment of human rights, and one of those is participation. You have to have an educated citizenry to know the issues and to be able to hold the leaders account. If they are not collecting the taxes in the first place, you have a gap there. The primary role of international organizations should be to fill that gap, to enable participation of citizens to hold their own leaders account. So I hope you read the paper when it's published. Thank you.
So I want to start by just adding my thanks to everyone who worked to organize this conference and also all of the participants. It's been so fascinating so far. And our small contribution to that is an examination of these issues, in particular from an African perspective, and particularly a look at whether the BEPS project is really effective in ensuring that multinational enterprises pay their fair share of taxes in Africa. And so I'm not going to rehash the resources for rights discussion that we've had throughout this conference, but the point that we want to highlight here is that in terms of those resources that are generated through tax in Africa, corporate taxes are particularly important, contributing an average of 29% of the total tax base, opposed to in developed countries where those are just 10% of total tax revenue. And that of that 29%, multinational enterprises are a particularly major contributor in developing nations where the domestic corporate tax base is limited. Unfortunately, as we've heard a number of times throughout this, it's difficult to mobilize those taxes from multinational enterprises because of BEPS, which are tax avoidance schemes that erode countries' tax bases and shift profits to low-tax jurisdiction. And as a result, the OECD's BEPS project has the stated goal of seeking to ensure that profits are taxed where the economic activities generating those profits are performed and where value is created. And we've heard a couple of times throughout these past couple of days that BEPS is not new. And I think Matti alluded to that, and so have several of the other panelists here. And I'm not going to go through the history of the whole thing here, but what we want to highlight is that in the development of draft model tax conventions, there has been a push and pull between conventions that favor developing countries or source countries and developed countries, residence countries. And over the course of time, really particularly with the rise of the OECD as the primary international organization working on these issues, the model tax conventions that favor developed countries, that favor residence countries, have really won out. And of course, there is also the alternate process through the UN that has developed its own model tax convention, but efforts by developing countries to give that organization more power, more voice in this debate have been roundly rejected by developed nations. Which leads us to our fundamental question, which is, does the OECD's BEPS agenda address the fundamental international tax reform issues that are pertinent to African countries? And essentially, our answer is no. So we argue that both the framing of the problems that the BEPS agenda seeks to address and the solutions that BEPS proposes are geared towards the curtailing the tax practices that are of concern to OECD and G20 member states. And as a result, the OECD BEPS project has failed to take the opportunity to address the fundamental question, which is the allocation of taxation rights between source and residence countries. And as a result, the questions that are most important to developing nations, including those in Africa, have been left out of this agenda. And we argue that as a result, the developed nations that are members of the OECD and the G20 are really failing to meet their extraterritorial human rights obligations and their obligations as members of the international community. And so I'm going to turn this over to Annet, who's going to talk about some of the specific ways in which the fundamental questions haven't been resolved.
All right, so the BEPS agenda, like she has just said, is intended to ensure that profits are taxed where the economic activities that generate those profits are actually performed. But the issue here is that from the very beginning, the OECD says that it's beyond its project to deal with the fundamental issues that deal with the allocation of taxing rights between residents and source stealth. But this has been the major focus and source of contention between source and resident states, whose interests when it comes to international taxation have been very different. We shall look at three main types of income that have of major concern to developing countries, and how this has not really been fair, and how the allocation of the income relating these three types of income has not really very progressive when it comes to developing countries. Let's take a look at interest. The claiming of excessive interest is a major concern for developing countries, especially when multinationals set up subsidiaries in developing countries, and they keep on claiming excessive interest and ensure that, you know, there is lots of base erosion that takes place in these countries. And some of the measures that are applied in most of these developing countries and many other countries to curtail these excessive interest deductions is, for example, the arm's length principle, fixed and equity ratios, use of targeted anti-avoidance rules, and withholding taxes. But you find that the emphasis of the BEPS project has always been about strengthening anti-avoidance rules, and there is not much emphasis about looking at other avenues of dealing with these issues. When it comes to interest, BEPS Action 4 recommends a debt EBITDA fixed ratio rule of between 10 to 30% that will be supplemented with a wide group ratio that is supplemented by other forms of provisions that reduce the impact of the rules on other entities. But the issue about this is that the emphasis on anti-avoidance provisions only addresses just part of the problems. If you look at the treaty allocation rules, when it comes to interest, they give primary taxing rights to the resident state, and the source state is actually also given a right to tax to a certain limit of 10%. The problem we have here is that when it comes to treaty negotiation, African countries or developing countries are at a disadvantage when it comes to treaty negotiation, in that they are always put in a situation where they have to sign very low or zero withholding tax rates. And this is a major concern, because if you look at the treaty rules, they provide a maximum rate of 10% for countries. But I think time has come for us to look at a minimum rate below which the treaty's rates should not be set. Let's look at the other type of income that is of concern to developing countries is royalties, which are derived, derived from the use of intellectual property will be taxed, and of course there will also be a claim of deductions when it comes by the payer of the royalties. Most African countries, of course, are importers of intellectual property, but there are also situations where African countries have been involved in the development of IP, and the famous case that has been flagged in this conference is the Sub-Miller case, where so many brands were set up in African countries, but because of the fact that IP is quite mobile, it has been migrated to low tax jurisdiction. And in the case of this Sub-Miller case, the IP was actually migrated to the Netherlands. If you look at some of the measures that countries apply, you have, again, your targeted anti-avoidance rules, the arm's length principle, and withholding taxes. And again, the treaty rules have not been very, very positive towards developing countries. If you look at the OECD Model Tax Convention, it gives the main taxing right to the residence country, and the source country has got a limited right to taxes only if it has got a beneficial owner in place or if there is a permanent establishment in place. If you look at the UN model, it does at least provide some rights for taxing by source countries to a certain minimum that would be agreed upon by the contracting states. But if you look at the OECD Model Tax Convention in article in Action 8, it places emphasis on using transfer pricing rules in order to deal with issues pertaining to loyalties. And the solution here is that legal ownership alone does not necessarily entail a right to all the returns relating to IP, but entities in, say, source states that are involved in the creation, development, enhancement, and maintenance, protection of IP would also be given a right to tax. But the concern here is that African countries and many developing countries have got major issues when it comes to transfer pricing. So the issues relating to allocation of taxing rights are actually not well addressed in that regard. I'll come to the last one, the issue of management fees. Lots of multinational enterprises keep on claiming lots of management fees for technical, administrative, and all sorts of fees. And the OECD Model Tax Convention does not have a clear-cut article on services. The only way that services could be taxed if there is a PE in that country or if there is a fixed base that is set there. And of course, the arm's length principle is going to be applied to attribute profits to the PEs. And the fact of the matter is that attributing profits to PEs has been a major concern for developing countries, especially especially when it comes to the OECD's authorized approach of attributing profits to permanent establishments and the fact that notional management expenses could be deducted. Many African countries and many other countries have signed actually treaties diverting from the OECD and the current UN model, where they have signed treaties that have got your services management and service fee article. The good news about this is that the UN is trying to develop a technical services article that will be included in its next issue. The concern here is that even if the OECD tries to address it matter, it's again taking the transfer pricing approach whereby it has come up with guidelines of how it will be benchmarking cross-border services by coming up with a simplified approach that does not use a fully fledged arm's length principle. Once again, the allocation of taxing rights when it comes to services has not been effectively dealt with. As I summarized, we have a situation whereby there are different concerns when it comes to the interests of source countries and residence countries, and the fundamental issue that has not been addressed by the OECD is the allocation of taxing rights between these two countries. The approach that has been taken is a piecemeal solution to problems, emphasizing a strengthening anti-avoidance provisions, and we have seen how multinationals have beaten these anti-avoidance provisions, so the question is, will strengthening them any further really help? And the fact that almost most of the solutions that it comes up with are falling back to the use of the arm's length principle as if it is the panacea of all solutions that relate to international tax problems. Essentially, source countries are almost left at the same position that they were if the position of how the international tax reform measures are being addressed as it is right now. The current international tax system, even if it fully incorporates the OECD BEPS action plans, fails to live up to the ideals that we were all looking up to, and it deprives African countries and developing countries at large with the policy space and resources that are necessary in order to fulfill their developmental objectives and the ability they would have to fulfill the human rights obligations of their citizens. That will be the end of my presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. I think we have about 15 minutes for some questions and answers. Who wants to? No? Yes? Can you please line up to the, at the?
Thank you very much. My name is Don Dare from the Pan-African Lawyers Union. I would just like to pose a question. I'm not certain that the last two presenters can answer it because it's an ambush a bit, but again, something that we could throw into the mix. And my question is, what could be the potential impact, or at least the significance, of evolving normative developments and institutional developments at the Pan-African level with this specific question of illicit financial flows, of taxation, or even if we frame it in a larger debate that has both corruption and illicit financial flows that has been mentioned. And I give two examples. In 2014, the African Union adopted a new legal instrument, a protocol to the current court that may establish an international criminal jurisdiction at the continental level, subject to getting 15 ratifications from the 54 member states. And it doesn't just criminalize the traditional core crimes of genocide, war crimes, crimes against humanity, but also corruption as an international crime in Africa, money laundering as an international crime in Africa, a new crime called illicit exploitation of natural resources, also bearing in mind that a lot of the tax evasion and so on in our context happens in the extractive industry. And then, apart from individual criminal responsibility, it also provides for corporate criminal liability, so you can try a corporation separate from its directors. So my question then is, should this come into force, we could have in the world for the first time an international court that could try what we now call illicit financial flows. How would that be a game changer? Secondly, also, the AU has passed an African mining vision and has set up a treaty implementing body known as the African Mineral Development Center. And one of the things that it's pushing the countries to do is to look at mines, extractive industry, as a focus for development. So all matters, including fiscal policy and so on. And it's pushing for country money visions to do this. And these country money visions might then be translated into laws and policies at the national level. So that also possibly could be a game changer that was not intended in the field of taxation, but could place a normative requirement on states or Africa to act as a whole to implement certain changes that might have an impact in what we're discussing today. Thank you.
Thank you. Would you like, Annet? I think this is mostly for you.
I just don't know how to address your question, but possibly just to comment. I think we are dealing with two diverging issues that maybe could be brought together by the issues we are attending to in this conference relating to human rights issues. The broader issue is about capital flight, which could either be licit or illicit, and I think the broader discussion by non-government organizations is to limit, is that the concern is the capital is flowing out, and maybe if it is done legally or illegally, it still does not matter. But as the rules stand right now, illicit financial flows is illegal, and those are the issues that you're dealing with, and that could be addressed through the criminal systems of the country. But when you come to the things that were the focus of our paper, the BEPS issues, those are essentially, so to speak, as the rules stand right now, legal, although they are the gray, dark areas that would flow over into the illicit. We are basically dealing with the way multinationals kind of use legal means, so to speak, in order to avoid taxes. Of course, the bridging gap between the two is that whether illicit or illicit, there is capital flight that is affecting many countries, developing countries at that, and one of the major issues is exchange of information will be very instrumental to ensure that we bring the taxes that have been lost or the revenue that is being lost into the coffers of the countries involved. I think that is the central focus, the exchange of information issue.
I just want to thank you for those for that comment, which I think highlights some really interesting potential legal strategies, and actually bring up one other one that I think might make some of the human rights people in this room groan a little bit. But the African Commission for Human Rights has recognized the right to development as fully justiciable, and I think that that presents another really interesting alternative way to bring a concrete legal claim about some of these tax evasion, tax avoidance, tax abuse issues and the way that they actually affect human rights, particularly the right to development. So thank you.
I'm sorry, Atiya Waris, University of Nairobi. I'd like to add to the conversation. Yesterday somebody said something about a lot of discussions are now happening in Africa that are moving outwards, and that's probably the one issue that really is happening. So 4 years ago, and Asha can confirm if I'm wrong, the African Commission of Human and People's Rights already passed a resolution stating that capital flight had a direct effect on the ability of African countries to achieve human rights, and that there was a need to start to study international financial flow and the effect it was having on the continent. After that, they passed several other resolutions, and I can give you the details later, that then added on to the need to build into it. At the same time, the African Union then passed the Mbeki panel report that has caused a lot of controversy on the definition of IFF, but again, back to the concern between international financial flows and the effects it's having on development, and bouncing off the fact that we have the Declaration on the Right to Development that started from Africa through Kebambaye, was pushed through as a declaration at the end of the process, because we had the same back and forth between the Global North and the Global South. And we've kind of come full circle now, because we are now looking at enforcement and implementation, which is what Donald brought up. And it's actually creating a whole picture, but from a regional perspective. And I think it would be really interesting to start to see other continents beginning to develop a similar direction, or at least thought process, to see what they would like in their parts of the world.
I think what we should do, because we are going to run out of time pretty quickly, and I see that there's at least one more question.
Yeah, so just make one quick point on that. The biggest problem in a lot of these countries is a lack of whole of government approach. The resources ministry takes a different approach to the tax ministry. They don't talk. So I think any instrument which actually binds you to whole of government approaches would be very important in this area. I think that's a lot of the problem for tax people working in extractive industries, deals that they're not aware of, approaches that they're not aware of, and lack of communication, and different views about what the mine should result in the country. Thank you.
Thank you.
I have a sense, are there other questions? Yes, can you line up, please? Yes, go ahead, please.
This also connects with the corruption discourse that's coming up in connection with domestic resource erosion. And I think I just want to say that we need to be mindful of just discussing corruption without also discussing the range of drivers, the structures and systems that actually enable and benefit by it. In where I come from, the part also coming from a regime that was had an issue with capital flight, the Marcos dictatorship, that was largely pinning the blame on us for allowing such corruption to take place, and the capital flight that ensued from that regime. And we hear the same narrative again coming from the World Bank, without actually the World Bank owning up also to its own responsibility in actually supporting such regimes, knowing full well that corruption was going on. And there was also, of course, the consequence of negative financial resource flows. Thank you.
Thank you. I wonder if you could shed some more light on the justiciable right to development in the domestic context, especially in light of the fact that in some countries in Africa, I speak for Nigeria, for example, ECOSOC rights are not justiciable. So how does that, how do you discuss that in light of this right to development you just spoke about? Thank you.
So I think this seems to be the end of the question. So what I'd like to do is to invite all the panelists to respond to any of the comments or to raise any other issue before the end of this panel. So please go ahead.
Okay. So I'll speak to that last question, which is just yes. Essentially, there's a huge difficulty in litigating economic and social rights at the domestic level across the board, I think around the world, and which I think is what makes it particularly interesting and useful and something that really hasn't been used very much yet or tested or advanced is this jurisprudence. There's essentially one case where the African Commission on Human Rights has recognized the right to development as justiciable before that court. And of course, there are all sorts of questions of, you know, who can bring claims before that court, who those claims can be brought against, that make it a complicated but interesting avenue to pursue. But I agree with you that at the domestic level, it's not very feasible almost anywhere.
I think this is where the devil are in the details, because along the same lines as you're speaking about, you know, being an American, I look to see, which treaties that the United States had ratified. And all they had ratified, you know, the Civil and Political Rights Treaty. They haven't ratified the Economic and Social Rights, so they're not obligated to the Maastricht principles or extraterritorial obligations. So I really have to hand it to the human rights folks who are looking for avenues to bring these claims. And that's why my last slide, which I didn't get to, so I'm going to bring it up on the slide right now. You know, I think strategically, as a tax justice community, we need to think about parallel options in terms of mass mobilization. And I think there's a lot more that could be done in terms of getting folks on the streets in developed countries.
Thank you. I'll just do pulling together some of these issues. I think there's that increasing but responsible source country taxation can really be harnessed for the purposes of the SDGs and for furthering human rights. But I think there is an issue as to whether the developing architecture of tax systems is putting the lid on that. It's putting the lid on source country taxation where there is value created in developing countries, and is putting the lids on the benefits that can, don't necessarily, but can flow from that in terms of human rights. And I think obviously, I think the UN needs a bigger role in this area to ensure that those two things work together, are synergized. But obviously, there's a lot of resistance to that. Thank you.
I think the disappointment that developing countries had was that they thought that BEPS was actually about rewriting the rules as they were, and that an opportunity has come for the process that was derailed after the League of Nations and the development of the Model Tax Convention, that now time has come to address these issues. And the fundamental issues, like I said in the presentation, was the allocation of taxing rights. As long as that issue is not addressed, and all that we attended to was trying to make sure that each country protects its share of the taxed cake, then actually we're not addressing the fundamental issues, and we are dealing with just the fruits of the problem because of the global financial crisis. So ultimately, developing countries have been left in the position that they are, and every one of us is just scrambling to protect our own turf. And as it stands, I think the OECD lost an opportunity to review and change the rules of the game as they stand. So we are still at the place that we are in, and that affects developing countries' ability to fulfill their fundamental rights and the whole topic that we are discussing right in this conference. Thanks.
Well, thank you very much. I think we're out of time. So thank you. Let's give a hand to all of the panelists. Thank you very much.